Hello and welcome back to the channel. So now let's talk about the next item on the list of the kinematics chapter, which is now forward kinematics. In the beginning, we talked about the frame matrix and we defined the concept of the frame matrix. And we said that a frame essentially can be used to describe a space or a moving frame or a moving smaller world or a smaller coordinate system in space. And then we described that this matrix can be then described using this form of a matrix. A vector form for a position and then three vectors for directions that results in this frame matrix. And we also talked about the importance of frames in robotics. We said that each individual frame can then be used to describe important elements on the robot, like joints, sensors, camera, like we saw in the last video. And then we talked about features or the properties of frames, such as, you know, the compound nature of it and how to find its inverse and so on. And then we moved to the next chapter, which was transformations. And what is it? Yeah, transformation. Yeah, here. So when we talked about transformation, we described that transformation is not, if you have one frame and then you have a final frame, then how do you transform from one frame? How do you actually make the transformation from here, from A to B? So obviously, as you can see from the simple diagram, it involves linear transformation, which is change in position and then orientational change. And that's what we saw in the last couple of videos when we talked about linear and rotary transformations. And then we talked about this is the linear example of a linear transformation, and we talked about rotary transformations, local and global. And then, of course, we talked about we did all of these examples. I suggest you rewatch the videos in case you missed or you didn't. If in case you came here directly, I suggest you go back and you watch those videos. Then we talked about global and local coordinates and the effect of this is the local coordinate and this is the global coordinates and how the rotation. It's important for us when it comes to the rotation to know about which axis are you rotating. Is it about the local axis or is it about the global axis? Okay, and then we talked about visual, although not in this order, but let's just agree that we already completed this part, which is graphical transformations. And although that graphical transformations may not give us, may be limited in application or in use, but they are definitely useful. Whereby we can use the environment to identify important information that then can be used to find some form of a matrix that can represent the robot. Although this matrix will not be in the robot parameters like length and angles and joints, but it will be nevertheless useful if you would like to find a mathematical matrix numerically that describes or can be used to describe the state of the robot. And we solved a couple of examples. This is one example. This is the second example. And we talked about this example, which we took our time with it, and so on and so forth. In fact, about this example, I want to add one more slide. I feel that this particular slide will be useful to visualize once again. I feel that this part right here, when we were converting the orientation, here, I would like to do this again, but visually clearer a little bit. So I'm going to do it again. What happened here? Yeah, I'm going to do it again on this slide right now. So once again, the problem was that, let me switch to, why is this shown here? I want to hide it. Okay. So basically, I want to, yeah, so we have the situation was like that. So you have, this was the frame, one frame, right? And this was the red frame, I think. Yeah, this was, oh no, let me fix that. So this was essentially, I want to use exactly the same colors, so for consistency, yeah. So yeah, and then we can change now to pen. And this was the frame that we want to reach. This is the target. And I think this was Z right here. This is Z. And this is Y. And this is X. terrain. And we are basically, the blue frame is the regular frame, right? And I'm not going to draw it on top of each other like earlier. I'm going to basically draw it somewhere here. So just say another revision of that. Oh, basically, we are revisiting that example again for clarity. So this is Z, and this is X, and this is now Y. And we would like to figure out what kind of transformations we want to get so that we can start from here, from this kind of orientation, and end up in this orientation. What are the changes in orientation? Yeah, let's just assume for a second that this blue frame right here is actually already here. But in order for us to visualize those changes, we need to draw it a little bit away. So as you can see, we may not be able to achieve this transformation, or you know, the complete transformation from one frame to another in one step. We may have to do it in multiple steps. So basically, our target is to start at this orientation and somehow through a couple of steps end up at this orientation. Okay, we cannot basically do that into one step, so we have to make maybe a temporary step along the way. So I'm going to use the black color. So as you can see, the very first thing is that here, in this example right here, Z is on the top, but then Z is down here, is in the bottom. So logically speaking, the very first action that we want to do is to rotate about this Y angle 180, so that this will result in this Z axis coming up here. So that will result, if we actually travel this way, right, like this, so the Z will come down here so that it can look like this guy. So that was basically the first action, which is essentially rotate. You know what? I'm going to ignore this. So I'm going to draw it here. So after you actually do this action, after you rotate about Y, the frame will look like this. In fact, let's clean it up. Yeah. That's okay. We can just draw it somewhere here. Okay, so pen. All right, so now after we do this action, basically the frame will look like this. This is now Y, and now this is going to be Z. This is what happened after you rotate about Z, rotate about Y, sorry, and the amount of angle is 180. And don't forget, when we do the rotation, we have to apply the right-hand rule, which is this. Using your thumb pointing along with this arrow, I'm going to try my best to draw a right hand here. So if this was your thumb, so your other fingers will be pointing towards the direction of the rotation. Okay, so excuse my skills here, but this is my best effort to draw the right hand rule. So right here will be the direction of the positive direction of the axis, and therefore your rest of your fingers will be pointing to the positive direction of the rotation. So that's the right-hand rule. So using your thumb, you can actually visualize your thumb pointing along with this arrow, and then your fingers will be, the rest of the other fingers will be pointing along this positive direction. So 180. Now, this is the thing. When we rotate this whole frame, we don't only move Z, we also moved X, because X also moves along. It's the whole frame moving together. So when this X frame, when this Z moved 180, also X moved 180. So basically the x-axis will also move, and it's going to come down here because it too moved 180 degrees. So therefore, the situation after we did this action is like this. So now the x-axis is here, and the z is here, and the y is here. We can call it, if you want, prime, like x prime, z prime. One prime basically means after one step. So from here to here, in order for us to get to here, this will be rotate, this will be this action right here, which is rotate Y angle 180. Okay, there is no need to write it one more time, or you know what, let's just do it. So this will be rotate Y angle, okay, this is horrible. So basically, this is the action right here. And now, this is basically the first step. Now, the second step will be, okay, now that we have reached this, you know, temporary orientation, we still not achieved our target. This is our final target. So now we look at this current situation and look at the final situation and see what we can do here. you can clearly see that the y is here and the x is here, but then if I rotate about z, basically if I come here now, you know what, I wish I can just copy paste. I don't think I can, yeah. This is unfortunately not possible, but I'm gonna write it here, yeah. So basically, rotate basically y angle 180. This is the first action. The reason why I wrote it up there is because I need to erase the space in below here. And now we want to basically, what we want to achieve here, we want to bring this y-axis to be like this. So what we want here, and we want to come to this frame right here. And let me change to the pen again. And this time I'm going to go to, you know, red color. Yeah, sure, red color. So now what we want, this y-axis, which is, or the y-prime axis right here, I want to bring it now to become here. Is that right? And when you do so, this will become y double prime, the next step. And when y come here, in order for you to rotate y this way, you'll have to rotate this angle, which again follows the right-hand rule. If your thumb pointing downward, so this will become the positive direction of the value. So that will be, or maybe I should have written this way, yeah? Yeah. So that will be the 90 degrees. So essentially, if you rotate around the current z-axis, yeah, 90 degrees, then the y-axis will go to the direction that you want. And at the same time, when y goes, x will also go here. So the new x-axis will be somewhere here, and that will be x double prime. And that's essentially is what we have here in the end. So in order for us to move from the second step to the last step, we will have to apply another rotation, which is rotate about the local z-axis. So let me clean up a little bit here. So basically now, yeah, black. So pen. So this is the first step, which is rotate about z, excuse me, rotate about y 180. And then from here, not highlight, pen, yeah. So, okay. So from here, rotate one more time. How much now we need to rotate about the local z-axis. So rotate about z angle 90. I think in our last session I said negative 90. That was a mistake because I double checked the right hand rule and that actually works. If you really, I don't want to draw a hand again, but if you want, that would actually look like this. So yeah, let's do it. So that will look like this. So that's your thumb. And then again, that's your fingers will be pointing this way, okay? So again, that's the positive direction of the motion and so on, okay? I was good in art when I was young. Okay, so basically that's how, so once again, this is the x-axis, so then that will be the positive direction of the motion, so we're good to go. And then, so in this case, now we figured out that in order to transform from the beginning, from the original frame until the last frame here, you need to have two actions, and they are in this order. First, you do this rotation, and then you follow by this rotation. So that is why the action in the correct order will be rotate y 180, and then followed by rotate z 90. And that's basically how do you do the rotations. Now, in the earlier, of course, in the original example, there is also a translation, which is translate 1.9. Remember that? So obviously, you have to do translate 1.9, and then you do the two rotations. So basically here, so that will be trans 0, 0, and then 1.9, okay? And then that will be essentially T 2 to 3. Okay, my handwriting is becoming worse here, but I hope you get the idea. So basically, yeah, let me just clear this up, and this will be, yeah. I'm just gonna try to clean up a little bit here. So yeah, so this right here will be 1.9, right? And then here you will have a rotation, and that basically is the situation. You have one translation, followed by two rotations in this correct order, and then that will be the transformation required. Now, I remember, let me do one thing here. Escape, but keep everything. And I want to copy this whole slide and put it here, V. Okay, good. So now let's go back to from current slide. So now basically what I want to do is, last time or earlier when I was in a class, what I was saying is, erase. Can we still erase? Oh, we cannot erase now because this has been kept. Okay, so what I was trying to say, no, maybe in that earlier page. Can I erase now? Oh, no. Okay, my bad. Keep. So, yeah, then all of this will have to go now. But I have it in another slide. So basically now, now we can now start. Let's start again the slideshow from the current slide. Okay, now what I want to do again is I'm going to draw the same two frames, but I want to talk about something else. So again, here's the blue color and here's the situation. So this is X and this is Z and this is Y. And here over here, let's draw the same target, change the color to red. So again, we have here, and then this is Z, this is X, and Z was here. So this is Z, and this is Y, and this is X. So once again, this is the target to get from this point to this point. Now, earlier we thought rotate about Z and then rotate about Y, okay? I want to now show you that we can still do this in a slightly different way. Well, let's see what we can do. First, if I actually decided to think about X instead of Z, I can see that in order to get X to this orientation, I just have to rotate about Z. So I can then start, we can just do this, rotate about Z and the angle will be 90 degrees. Is that right? Well, let's see what that will give us. So that will give us this situation. So different color, yeah, sure. So now we're gonna have this particular thing. Okay, that's ugly. So let's erase that. Okay. So now let's start with this action. So this action right here will result, still ugly, but we'll have to live with it. So now this is X, okay, and this is Y, and now this is Z, okay? Okay, so now this is the situation, and in order to get here, what we did was rotate Z angle 90. Is that right? Yes, that's right. Again, your thumb is going this way, and then your fingers will be going this way. So that's correct. That's 90 degrees. Okay, now that we are in this particular step, I want to think about, okay, X is already here, and Y is already here, and Z here. All we have to do now is rotate about X. Is that right? Now I'm going to change the color. So first, let's remove this extra line. Okay. So now if you think about it, in order for us to change to pen, just get another color here. Now, in order for us to get, now let's think about y-axis. This is the current situation of y, and I want it to get here. So all I can do right now is simply to rotate about x, is that right? And if I rotate about x, what is going to happen? The y is going to come here, is that right? And at the same time, the z is going to go down also, right? Also 1 degree. So the z is going to come down here, resulting exactly in the same situation in our target. Okay, we are back to this situation again, so let's clean this one up. So now let's use the pen. So now, after you do the second action, which is rotate about the local x-axis, so then you'll get rotate about x 180. Okay? That will result in a situation in x, and then z will be down here. Is that right? And then x or y will be there, and that actually, again, resulting in the same target that we have over there. Is that right? So then erase this extra line. And then we can then see that in order for us to start from this transformation or from this frame into this frame, we can now do this. We can say, actually, the action is rotate Z 90 multiplied, then followed by rotate X. Oh, this again. Okay, let's clean this up. Okay, so once again here, pen. So, x and the value was 180. Is that right? And don't forget, we have a translation in the beginning. So we have translate, trans, and then that will be 0, 0, and then 1.9. Is that right? Now, let's take a look at this situation, compare it with this situation. Well, over here, we said, okay, this is the same translation, so no difference here. But then we have here rotate about y 180 followed by rotate about z 90. I don't know if you can hear this noise, but there is some announcement in our neighborhood. I hope you can ignore it. But anyway, so now right now, what we have here is the situation is that we have rotate about y 180 followed by rotate about z 190. But in the second solution, we have rotate about z 90 and then rotate about x 180. And I can tell you there is other solutions as well. We can do this again. We can find another combination. You know what I mean? So there are actually multiple solutions, but if you do the math and you do the multiplications, you're gonna come up with the same answer. And I suggest once again that you do this exercise. Remember that this is actually, maybe this writing right here is not clear, but actually this is the transformation matrix right here. These three actions, these are the transformation from 2 to 3, okay? But also, this is also 2 to 3, okay? This is also the transformation from frame 2 to frame 3. And although they have look like they're different actions, but they're actually going to result in the same thing in the end. So that is why I suggest that you develop this matrix. Oops, okay, that was a terrible line. So basically, I suggest that you develop both matrices and then you check the comparison and you will see that it's actually the same answer, right? So that's what I wanted to show you in a previous example, a previous video, but I didn't have the time. That how you can visualize the question and how two different people can come up with the same, two different actions, yes, but they will come up with the same answer in the end. So that's why I suggest that you, as an exercise, perform this workout yourself. Do the multiplication and verify that although different actions, it will result in the same result. Okay? Of course, symbolic operations, and we talked about symbolic operations before, and we said that the purpose of symbolic operation is that it will help us develop equations. And we've seen this example already a couple of times, so let's not dwell on that again. And now let's move to our chapter of today, which is forward kinematics. All right, so we spent about 20 minutes talking about a more graphical example, but it's fine. That's not really that bad. In my opinion, I always say it, that forward kinematics is the easiest part of kinematics. Right now, of course, everything looks difficult, but once you go along and you go to inverse kinematics and stuff like that, then you will see how simple forward kinematics is in comparison to inverse kinematics. In a summary, I can tell you that forward kinematics, as soon as you have the robot matrix or the matrix that describes the robot, then you can say your job is done. Then the rest is just simple calculations, simple mathematical calculations. So let's see what's the content of this chapter today. First of all, we're going to talk about the robot matrix. What do you mean by robot matrix? Then we're going to talk about the standard robot. We're going to reintroduce them. We have seen them before, but we're going to reintroduce them. Cartesian, cylindrical, spherical. No, actually, not articulate. Articulate will not. The articulate robot is not going to be part of our syllabus. Please excuse this part. So this is not included. And the reason for this, you will see later on today. So once we learn about these guys, and then we will see how to develop the robot matrix, but for these standard robots. Okay? Specifically for these three robots, okay? And the reason why we call them the standard robot, because they are widely used in the industry. And if you go to the industry and you talk about it, talk to engineers, as soon as you say Cartesian robot, everybody will know what you're talking about. If you say cylindrical robot, again, they will understand what you're talking about. And the same thing for spherical and the articulate. The non-standard robot means customized robot or the things that you designed, et cetera, et cetera. I really had to do something about the chair noise. I hope I can do this. Remember to do this before next video. Okay, next we're going to talk about graphical. Again, we're going to use geometry and graphical to develop the robot matrix. And we're going to only introduce the theory part only of this method, which is the Dinnerwirth-Hartenberg notation or convention or method to develop the robot matrix. And then we're going to do some examples, but the examples will not include the DH method because the DH method is outside of the syllabus of this course. However, I will, for those who are watching YouTube, I will make a separate video only on the DH method, but that will be in a later time. Then we do examples, and then once we learn how to develop the T matrix or the robot matrix, then this whole part can become really easy peasy and can become very simple to go through, and then we will see how we go about it. A word of notice, a word of reminder to the students taking the course with me in this semester, is that you need to pay extra attention for these two robots right here. The 2-degree of freedom planar robot and the 3-degree planar robots, because these are the robots that we will use in our virtual project for this course. Because we are applying virtual semester and virtual content, we will then focus our attention on these robots. That doesn't mean that the other robots are not important. They are, but then we will focus our analysis on for the project on these two robots alone. And this is no secret. If you go to the project outline on our Moodle page, you will find that the project outline actually describes these two robots again. So let's talk about developing the robot metrics. How do we go about it? So once again, let's just quick recap. We can say that the robot matrix essentially is a frame matrix, but this frame matrix describes the whole robot, not just an individual frame or an individual joint, but the whole robot and all of its frame joints, elements, and important items. That means joints, links, geometry, important items like locations of sensors, like the camera example. Remember that in the earlier video, in the last video when we saw the example about camera, and so on and so forth. So how do we develop the robot matrix? Well, we first have to have the individual frame matrices. So the frame for, link number one, and the frame for, joint number one and joint number two. And we have to first develop those frames. Okay, let's say we did all of that. And then what's next? The next step will be to transform or develop the transformation from the base of the robot all the way until the end of the robot. And once again, we have done this step in our earlier example. If you notice the graphical examples we've seen in the last video, actually earlier in this video, we were also doing transformations from the base of the robot until the end of the robot. So we were actually indirectly developing the robot matrix. But we were using environment, okay? So now we're not going to use environment. We're going to use the robot joint parameters. Okay, so once the robot matrix is ready, it can act as a model to the robot. And we can use it for kinematics, but we can also use it for many other applications. Not just robot kinematics. We can use it for simulation of the robot, animation. We can use it also for visualization of the robot. We can also do MATLAB and Sibelink analysis on it. As soon as you have the formulas that can represent the robot, then you can do whatever you want with it. So we're going to begin now. So which means that in order for us to do robot kinematics, we first have to develop the robot matrix. Like I said, as soon as you have the robot matrix, then the process is straightforward. Okay, so how do we develop the robot matrix? And this is where we're going to talk about right now. Now, for the industrial or the standard industrial robot, the process is straightforward and it's basically standard, right? So that's why we're going to proceed rather quickly. So let's begin with the standard robot, which is Cartesian, cylindrical, and spherical. By the time we finish the spherical, then you'll get the point into how do we solve it for the, you will see why we did not include the articulate. So this is the Cartesian robot. We have been introduced before. It involves three linear motion or three prismatic motions, X, Y, and Z. And there is no rotation. And therefore, this particular robot is pretty much straightforward, right? You have three linear motion, X, Y, Z. And therefore, if you want to move this end effector, so all you have to do is tell us how much is this distance, which is Z. How much is that distance, which is y? Okay, this is happening again. So let me get rid of that. So basically now we can see that the vertical distance, the vertical height of the end effector is basically z. And then if you want to move the line or along or parallel to this line, that essentially could be x or y according to your definition. And then if you want to move along this line, that could be again, why can't I just do on Control Z here? Let me see if I can do that. There's a Control Z. No, cannot. If I Control Z, it will do something else. I'll figure this one out and hopefully try to prevent this from happening. So again, so this particular line right here will be in parallel with this line over here. So again, you have x and y and z. So this is z, this is x, let's just define it as x, and this will be y. And you can see that these are also the same coordinates as a Cartesian coordinate. And that's why this robot is called the Cartesian, because it follows the Cartesian coordinates. So therefore, the transformation matrix for the Cartesian robot is simply, is exactly the same transformation matrix for linear, or you know, the translation. So, which is essentially, last time we saw this, it was dx, dy, dz, but now it's simply, what's the coordinates that you want? Px, py, pz, okay? It seems too easy, so let's move on to something a little bit more difficult. So now we have the cylindrical robot. In order for you to transform the cylindrical robot from the base of the robot until the end of it, let's say we started at this point right here, and we want to end up at this point right here. In order for you to do so, you have to do the following actions. You will have to basically follow this sequence of events. Translate along L, basically go vertically along L. Then, assuming that this was the original orientation, so you have to rotate about Z, this angle. And then you'll have to travel along X, or the X axis again. Or you know what, let me draw this again one more time. So erase. This looks like a jumbled bunch of lines here. So let's try one more time. So this time I'm going to draw it in frames, yeah. So once again, you have this original frame, okay? The original frame is actually is right here. And this original frame now is Z. And this is, you know what, let's put X here rather than, you know what, it's okay, let's put X, let's put Y here, and this is X, okay? So as you can clearly see, we first have to travel all the way here. So that will be up until this translation. So in order for us to get to this point, we'll have to do this action, which is translate distance L. And this height right here is available to us and is equal to L, okay? Okay, now that we are here, I know that this looks like we can just travel along the line, but we can't because we need to travel along X. So we have to rotate this frame up until we get here. So I know that this looks like a 90 degrees, but actually it isn't. You know, my drawing is not really good at all, so I'm gonna have a bad example. Let's say that the original frame, the original X axis, right? For some reason was like this, yeah, the original x-axis, yeah. So let's say the original x-axis was this way. For whatever reason, let's just agree that this was the x-axis, and therefore this is now the y-axis. It has to be as much as I can 90 degrees here. Then we go up, this will be the z-axis, the x-axis, and then this will be the y-axis. Okay, so now I cannot do anything with this frame because I need to rotate it. So in order for us to translate to this point, this particular point looks like this. This is X, because if you remember at the end, this is N, yeah, N-O-A, remember that? And this is Y, which is O, which is the orientation, and this is A, which is the approach, okay, or Z. So in order for you to get to this frame, I need to do a little bit of rotation here. I actually need to do this. I need to rotate until here, and at the same time, this also has to rotate. And how much angle we have to rotate? This is basically alpha, which is the twist, which is the one that you see right here. Rotate about Z. Again, the same Z you see here, rotate about Z, angle alpha. And once you rotate about Z, the X axis will essentially come here, right here, and then we can translate along X until we get to this point. And this distance is R, which is the last transition you see here. Okay, I'll give you a minute to think about it, where then we can move on to the next frame. Okay, so now let's continue with this. So now that you know these actions, from here on in, it's just like our previous exercises. You essentially, this is a translation that comes before a rotation. So this is actually right here as a translation. you use a template, and this is a rotation, right? A matrix, and this is another translation right here. And then you write them in, you use the rotate about Z template here. This is the translation, and this is a translation. These two are a shortcut, they can combine. So you have one matrix, and this is the second matrix. You can then multiply, and you can develop this matrix right here. And I think, no, it's not shown. I'll leave this part for you as a workout. So it's your job as a, when you do this on your own time, to verify that these actions, after you multiply them together, they will result in this matrix. That's a job for you to do. Now, the next, actually, this solution will be shown later in the slides, but it's a good idea that you try to verify this action one more time. Now, of course, if you miss something here, it's fine, as long as you realize that this is the correct sequence of actions. Also remember that these are robot parameters. Yeah, this is a typo actually. This is not X, this is an R. Yeah, not X. Okay, so this is supposed to be this is a very ugly R. Yeah, this is basically R, not X. So rotate, this is L, which is the height. This is supposed to be H, I think, or height. You can call it L, no problem. Length, and this is the twist angle, alpha, and this is R, which is the reach. Okay, so we will come back again to the cylindrical robot in a while. Now let's move on to the spherical robot. The spherical robot, we can do something similar. We can again start with a frame matrix, and it's right here. This is X, and this is Z, Y, and this is Z, okay? Now, the very first thing, in order for us to get to this point, right, we need to do two things. First of all, we need to rotate about Z. Oops, let me clean up a little bit here. I'll try my very best to explain this, but once again, if you missed out on the action, it's fine. So very first action is right here. So you have to rotate about Z, okay? But the Z will be obviously the same. So this right here, this rotation right here will be, this is rotate, this will be rotate about Z value gamma, which is this action you see right here. Okay, I'll try to zoom in and show you what's going on. So eventually you try to, we are rotating about the Z axis. This is the Z axis. And that angle will be gamma. So the new frame will look like this. So this is now going to be X and this is going to be Y. Okay. Or in other words, maybe I can draw it somewhere here. So originally, let me draw it here. So this is the original frame. Yeah, this is Z and this is basically X. This is Y and this is Z. And after you do the second action, the new frame will look like this. This is still Z. This is now Y and this is X. Basically, what we did was we rotate about Z and the angle was gamma. Okay? So now this is the new frame. So what are we going to do with it? Now what we're going to do, this is the Y axis right here. We're going to rotate about this Y axis like this. Rotate about Y axis angle beta. So when you rotate about y-axis, the z-axis and the x-axis will move, right? The z-axis will come here, so this is going to be here, and the x-axis will move here. Is that right? So let's call this x prime, and then this is z prime. So right here, this is the angle beta. This is the action rotate about beta, and as you can see it from here. So the final frame or the next frame will be like this. So this will be x, this will be z, and this will be Y. Okay. Okay. Finally, what do we do? Well, by the time you do that, this will be Z right here. Okay. By the time you do that, then we travel along Z. Basically, we translate along Z until we get to this point right here. So after the second action, after we rotate about B, after we do this transaction right here, after we rotate about B, Z will be along this line, along this line right here. This will be Z prime or double prime. Then we translate along Z, we get to this point, and that's what this last translation is. Once again, the best way to visualize this robot is to imagine the fire truck and the ladder of the fire truck. And imagine that you are sitting on top of it and you want to reach those people. So you sit on the cabinet in the initial position, which is right here. Yeah, which is right here. So first, you will be rotated about... rotate about Z, so that's the first rotation. And once the booth is here, then you're going to rotate about Y. So it's going to be here, and then you go up, and then that will be the position that you're going to be reaching. So once again, once we have developed those actions, I know that this visualization part might be a little bit difficult to grasp. It's okay. If you take my word for it and you agree that this is the actions, right? Hopefully I can find some animation for this online, or maybe you can. If you can find it, that would be great. Let's look for spherical robot transformation animation. Yeah, but if you can agree that this is basically the actions, then from here on in, once again, it's just a matter of multiplication. You have a template for rotate about ZY is right here. Just go and look up the template for rotate about ZY. The angle will be gamma. And then right here, that will be rotate about Y angle beta. Again, you go and look for the template for Y. And it's obviously a translation. And the translation comes after the rotation, so there is no shortcuts. You'll have to multiply these three matrices, and the result will be this one. And once again, I suggest that you do this exercise on your own and develop this matrix yourself, okay? So that's essentially the spherical matrix. So once again, verify this matrix, and this way you will know that you're becoming good at matrix multiplication in symbols. And see, the point of this, why I want you to do it yourself, is because you have a reference. You have already, this is already there for you as a reference. So you multiply these operations and symbols and you come up with this matrix successfully, then you know you are good, and or at least you're on the right path. Similarly here, you already have the action, transform into matrices and then multiply them. And then if you successfully reach this target right here, then once again, you are good to go. Once again, as a reminder, this capital C means cosine and this capital S means sign, but we're just reducing the clutter here, and that's why we're using capital C and capital S. Okay, so as an exercise, verify the robot matrix for a cylinder. Verify means you yourself perform the operations. If you're watching on YouTube, pause right now and try to perform this task yourself. And if you guys are watching in the classroom, I will give you 5 minutes. I will pause this video again. You guys go ahead and give it a try, and then we can discuss after the break. Okay, so I hope you paused and you tried on your own, and you're not just watching the solution. But if you did, and here we go. The actions are already given in this particular order, and then the action is given, so the T cylindrical is given in this action. And you can skip this part because the action or the order has already been given to you, and then this is the multiplication. So this right here, let me remove this ugly red line, and also let's change the color. Red is quite tiring to watch after a while. So basically, yeah. So what you're looking at right now essentially is, wait, let me remove the eraser. All right, so 10. Okay, so basically what's going on here is that this right here is translate along L. Okay, this is translate along L. This is the template for translation. We're good to go. And this is rotate Z about alpha. This is rotate Z about alpha. We just go up to the template of rotate Z and we just plug in the value for alpha. And this is translate X. And this is translate X right here. Okay. And once again, here we have a shortcut because we have a translation that comes before a rotation. So we just plug them together. So this is L right here. So we have two matrix, and now we're ready to multiply. Although this looks like multiplication, but because of the presence of all of these zeros and ones, this will become a very simple thing to do. One multiplied by cosine alpha, that's cosine alpha, and the rest will be nothing. So essentially, that's very easy for you to do this multiplication. And don't forget this one right here, we have R. So once you do the multiplication, you should come up with the same result you see here, okay? Once again, I strongly advise you that you should do this yourself. Even if you didn't try, or if you tried and failed, you should do this yourself in order to properly learn how to do matrix operations in symbols or in variables. The same exercise for a spherical. So that will result in here. Again, we have, again, the same situation. This is rotate Z gamma, so this is rotate about Z angle gamma. This is rotate, this is a typo, yeah? This is actually Y, yeah. So rotate Y beta, so again right here, thankfully this is the correct template. And this is translate along X, and here it, oh, this is, supposed to be, oh sorry, this translate along Z, not translate along Z. This is supposed to be translate along Z, yes, not translate along X. So if you go here, this is the typo right here. This should be Z, not X. This is correctly Z, yeah, and this is correctly Z, so thankfully the operations are correct. So when you put it here and you put it and you do the multiplications, and when I did this multiplication, I did these two first and then multiplied. If you decided to do these two first, it's fine. You should get into the same result in the end. And that's essentially how you come up with this matrix. And once again, I strongly suggest that you try it on your own first before you watch the solution. Okay, so now we move on to the next type of matrix, or the next method of developing the robot matrix, and that is using geometry. Sometimes, without knowing actions and without doing matrix multiplication, we can simply use geometry and trigonometry to develop the robot matrix. And one of the best candidates for this is planar robots. And planar robots, they are simply called planar because they are on one plane, as you can see here. And in this particular example, is the X and Y plane. So this is the X, and over here is the Y. So this is the X and Y plane. Of course, Z is coming out of the frame, but we're going to ignore it because we're not going to use it. So and what does that mean, planar robot? It means that this robot is moving, but only within the X and Y plane, and nothing to do, doesn't go in the Z direction. So does that mean that graphical is only limited for planar robots? No, we can definitely use graphical for 3D as well. But then the procedure will be quite complicated, and it depends on what robot are we talking about. That is why for those complicated 3D robots, we have another method for that. So that's why, of course, if the robot configuration, although in 3D but relatively simple, let's say it has a bunch of linear joints, then you can definitely go ahead with graphical if it's convenient for you. But if it's a quite a complicated design and then you go into multiple planes, and that's why geometrically speaking, it might become a little bit complicated. So that's why it really depends on the situation. So let's focus now on the graphical, the planar example in front of us. So we will apply geometry to develop the robot matrix for this particular 2DOF planar robot. So how do we do that? First, we have to develop the frames. We have to realize that this first joint right here, it has this first frame O0. And this particular frame is also along the line here. And let me try and change the, you know what, it's okay. Let me change the pointer. So again, you can see the reason why we put X along this line, because it's actually along the line of this X right here is along the global X axis. Usually the very first frame of the robot is parallel to the global frame. So this is a given. This is sort of always there. And then when you go to the next frame, it's usually along the same current length of the link as you see right here. And this is 90 degrees to it. And similarly here in this last frame right here. So in order for us to remember, if we talked about this before, that in order to develop the frame matrix of the robot, first we have to, step number one, to develop the frames of each joint. So that's the first step, which is developing the frame for each joint, okay? The next step would be to transform from the beginning until the end. And again, to transform from the root of the robot or the base of the robot until the end or until the hand of the robot. So in your example, there is no E and there is no ND factor. I know, just ignore that for now. We're just gonna focus on these two links only, okay? So as you can see, in order for us to develop the T matrix for this robot, we have to make two transformations. The first transformation is from frame 0 to frame 1. Is that right? And then the second frame will be from 1 to 2. Is that right? And if let's say we develop these two frames, then if we just multiply them together, we will then develop the frame from 0 to 2. Is that right? Well, frame 0 to 2 essentially is from the root or from the base until the hand or the end. In other words, the robot matrix. That essentially is the robot frame matrix. You know what I mean? So if we found a way to develop the value of T0 to 1 and T1 to 2, then we will be able to find the robot matrix. So let's do that. Or if you would like to think about it and develop it yourself, you can pause the video right now and go ahead. So let's begin with this first transformation, which is transformation from frame 0 to frame 1, which is T0 to 1. And as you can clearly see, in order for us to start from this frame and end here, let's think about the actions. What are the actions that are required of us in order to get here? And when I say get here, I don't mean just the position. I also mean the orientation. Once again, think about it. Just between these two frames only, what are the actions needed in order for you to go to transform from this frame to this frame? Pause and think about it. Okay. I hope you did pause and you thought about it, and let's now do it together. So first of all, in order for us to get to this point, I need to start by changing the orientation. So the very first thing I should do is essentially to change the orientation of the frame to this. And if you think about it, the value is right here. So all I really have to do is, the first action will be to rotate about which axis? About the Z axis, right? So rotate about Z angle theta 1, and the theta 1 is already available to you. Okay, all right, so now that you are here, what's next? Now that we have transformed to this section, second action, what are we going to do next? Well, now that we are here, all we have to do is translate along this line, is that right? Or in other words, along this axis, this particular axis. But what is that? This is basically x prime, and this is y prime. In other words, we need to translate along the local x-axis, is that right? Magnitude of equal to L1, is that right? We have to travel along this local x-axis, and the distance essentially is the length until here. And this distance essentially is the length L1, which is available to us. Let me write that again because it looks terrible. My handwriting using this apparatus is quite terrible sometimes, maybe all the time. So let's try again. So now the next action will be translate x, and that will be the distance L1. And now we know that since this is a local x-axis, right, or the rotated or the moving x-axis, obviously this is also local, right? So the order of application, or in other words, T0 or 0 to 1, ignore this guy, is going to simply be, basically means rotate Z theta 1 followed by translate X L1. And if you think about it now, now we have robot parameters. This is theta 1 and this is L1, which are parameters of the robot. We don't use environment values anymore. We use the actual parameters of the robot. So that's what, and also the second transformation will be A2. And if you think about it, A2 is very similar to A1. First, we have to do a rotation, is that right? And then we have to do a translation, and then we get here. So it's very, very similar to A1. So that's exactly what is shown here. The robot frame actually is the transformation from 0 all the way until the end, which is 2, which itself is made of two steps, from 0 to 1 and from 1 to 2. And some books, they use the different notation. Rather than using 0 to 1, 1 to 2, they just simply call it A1 and A2, and 1 here being the target or the end. By the time you get here, you're already at frame at point 1, so that's why we have 1 here. And A2 means, again, the same thing. You are reached point number 2, so therefore frame number 2, so that's why we call this A2. So whether you are using this notation, it doesn't matter. You should remember that they mean the same thing. So in order to we did this already, so I'm going to, this is just for you to exercise it. So in order for you to transform from frame 0 to frame 1, we must first rotate about z-axis at an angle equal to theta 1, then travel distance L1 along the rotated x-axis, which is the local x-axis. In other words, this will be the action, and I hope by now you know why this is the particular order, because this is a local x-axis, so it goes to the right. Okay, And similarly, we can see clearly that this is the same thing here. First, we have to rotate about Z and then translate along the local X. So we get, again, this. All right? And then we're putting it all together. We can see now that the robot matrix for the 2DOF planar robot, let's just highlight this guy a little bit. The T matrix of this robot essentially is made of multiplying these two or these four matrices all together. Now, let's take a look at this particular situation. All of these matrices are in terms of the robot parameters. What is now the robot parameters for this robot? The robot parameters now are essentially theta 1 and theta 2 plus L1 and L2. Well, those guys, you know, the links, sometimes we simply call this guy theta I, and this is essentially Li. Li means every L, and theta I simply means every theta. So obviously you can see that Li are constants in this particular example, but those are variables, could be any value from 0 to 360 or within the range of the allowable values for theta 1 and theta 2. Is that right? So, but these are actually together collectively are called robot parameters. Some people consider only the variables to be robot parameters. I consider even the constant values are also robot parameters. So your first example is to actually do this work yourself. Not first anymore, it's like your third, yeah? Your job, once again, is to perform this exercise yourself and develop the robot matrix for the 2DOF planar robot. So once again, pause the video and then try to complete this exercise, this multiplication on your own. Once again, you have the rotate Z template, just put theta 1 or simply call it 1, and you have the translation matrix and the same thing for here and the same thing for here, and then develop the robot matrix. I'll give you a moment, pause this video and then go ahead and try and do it on your own. Okay, I hope you did. So now let's move on and take a look at how this works together. So the very first step, obviously, is to realize that, let's just focus here for a minute. And you know what, this is all blue now, so I'm gonna change my color to red. So in order to, we agreed before that A1 is equal to, what is it? It's right here. So we agreed that this is basically A1, is that right? Right here, this is A1. Is that right? And A1 means rotate about Z theta 1, and this is translate L, translate along X. So this is basically the template for rotate about Z. This is the terminology. C2 simply means cosine theta 2. And S2 is sine, it's right here, sorry. C1 and S1 are simply means cosine theta 1 and sine theta 1, just for simplicity and also to reduce clutter. So when you see this in the future, you realize that this is actually cosine theta 1, and this is sine theta 1. This is obviously L1, which is given to us. And capital or small letter doesn't matter, as long as you know what's going on. So after you do this multiplication, you will come up with this matrix. Now, you could, of course, repeat this process and multiply again and come up with this matrix, which is A2. But then, otherwise, you can also use this lovely shortcut. You see, if you look at the transitions required for A2, you will see that these are exactly the same actions for A1. The only difference between them is just the values are different. Is that right? So here we have rotate about Z and then translate along X. Well, here we also have rotate about Z and then translate along X. It's just the values are different. So if that was the case, well, this matrix will definitely will be very similar to it. I mean, A2 will definitely going to be similar. We just have to change the values accordingly. So if this, where is my marker? Where's my pointer? Disappeared. Here. So basically, if this is the matrix that we developed for A1, so A2 must look like it. It just have to substitute different values. So whenever we had theta 1, it's going to be theta 2. And whenever we, this, because this is the situation. Whenever you have theta 1, we have theta 2. And we have, whenever we have L1, we have L2. We just substitute and we end up here. So again, you don't have to do multiplication. You can just use the concept of similarity. And this will be with us many times. Again, you will see this situation many, many times, that similarity between, especially when we have planar robots. You got me? So now that you have A1 and A2, what's next? Well, now that we have A1 and A2, we are here now. So this is now A1, and this is now A2. we can now perform the matrix multiplication. And I know this will look scary when you look at it for the first time, but actually right here, this is for the first time where we're going to begin. Actually, what's going on here, this answer right here, if you look closely, this will be the answer to the first row multiplied by the first column. So C1 multiplied by C2 minus S1 multiplied by S2, and then the rest are zeros. That's what you get here. And that's essentially what we have here. And if you repeat the process, you will get the same matrix that you see in this step. There's nothing we can do here except a little bit of cleaning. Like, for example, you can see that there's negative and negative. We just put them outside and we get this representation here. Oh, I know what the announcement was about. I don't know if you can hear this noise. I think they're fogging the area. Well, if you cannot hear it, then just ignore it. So basically, once again, this is an organization, so you can put the negative sign outside and they are both positives here. Now, similarly here, when you look at this situation, it looks a little bit messy, so you want to clean it up. You can see that L2 and L2 is common, so let's take L2 outside like this, and then we put the pattern or whatever left is inside here. You can see that we have C1 and C2, and we have S1 and S2. So we take it out along with the negative sign and with it. And we repeat the same process here as well, and we have this. Now, what's the benefit of this rearrangement is because for the first time, we're going to use trigonometry. I hope you remember that. That's why in the beginning of the course, I asked you to revise trigonometry. If you haven't revised trigonometry, I suggest that you pause this video and look at the description of the video, and then you could, if you are watching this on YouTube, then I put some links that describe trigonometric relationships that would help you to understand what I'm talking about here. If not, if you are watching this in the classroom, then I've already put this material onto Moodle, and then you can actually go and refer to it over there. But what's going on actually, that this is the definition of C12. What is C12? Essentially, it's cosine theta 1 plus theta 2. So this is essentially cosine theta 1. Oh, yeah, it's right here. So right here is essentially C1 essentially is cosine theta 1 plus theta 2 right here. And S12 is also sine theta 1 plus theta 2. And once again, this is just a simplification of the way we write this matrix. Okay? I don't expect you to memorize the trigonometric relationships, but you definitely need to revise them. It's a good idea to revise and sort of, I remember when I was in school, we actually had to memorize these orders. We had to remember C1, C2, and then S1, S2, that would be cosine 1, 2, and so on and so forth. But if you don't want to memorize, or if you want to refresh your memory on those, you can look at the trigonometric relationships either in the description of this video or in the Moodle sessions. Okay, now let's go back to this and take a look at the situation here. This is a typo. I think there's a mistake here. Yeah, this is a mistake. Let me correct this right now. Here. This is supposed to be S1, not C1. So yeah, S1. Okay, so now, if you look at the situation, this was the 31st joint. Basically, this is the T matrix that we developed for here. This is the T matrix that we developed here, which is essentially, this is A1, excuse me, this is A1, which is the frame, the description, the transformation from 0 to 1, okay? Now, if you look at frame 1, this is basically also is A1 right here. And if you see A1 again, and according to A1, this right here, is px. Remember, this is a frame matrix, right? And so this is what's going on. Px is L1 cosine theta 1, and py L1 sine theta 1. And from geometry, we know that that happens to be true. We know that actually this height you see here is indeed the length of the triangle, or the length of the of this length right here. Let me change the pen here. You can see that actually this height right here, is indeed is equal to this L multiplied by sine of the angle. And this horizontal length is equal to the length multiplied, or L1 multiplied by the cosine of the angle. So we just visually were able to verify. And another thing to notice on this matrix is that we remember when there was only one rotation in this. When if you go back a few slides ago to this, you will see that there is one rotation only. So that one rotation only is represented here. This is the one rotation only, which is equal to, again, rotate angle theta 1 about z-axis. Now, let's see the situation for the whole robot, okay? And I think there is the same mistake in my,
there's a bunch of mistakes here, so,
not a bunch, it's the same mistake, but it's repeated. So let me fix this one real quick. So this actually is sine, not cosine. And so let me just quickly do that. And let's copy this guy. And we move here. And here. No, it's not here anymore. Okay. Okay. So now so this is not the situation for the whole 2 degree of freedom robot. We developed the matrix. So we can see that this whole height right here is equal, according to this matrix, right? You see, this is again the matrix. And this whole item right here is Px. And this is Px right here. This whole thing is Px, okay? And this whole vertical line is Py according to geometry. But according to the matrix, this is also Py, right? And this is also Px, okay? And we can also show you visually and also using geometry that this is also true. Again, if you focus only on this triangle right here, you will notice that this distance right here, this distance right here is L1C1, is that right? Let me erase that extra annoying line, and also change the color. It's like as if I'm telling someone to change the color for me. I'm the one who's doing it myself. I don't know why I keep talking to myself. Anyway, so here, so you can see that this distance right here is L1 cosine theta 1, is that right? Right here, this from distance from the beginning until here. That's L1 cosine theta 1. But then again, this distance is in the second triangle or in this triangle right here, okay? And in this second triangle, this distance is actually used from these two angles, which happens to be theta 1 plus theta 2, is that right? So cosine theta 1 plus theta 2, or C12, which is this angle right here, multiplied by L2, which is this L right here, gives us this distance, is that right? So that's actually what you see here. So this is essentially, this is L2 multiplied by cosine theta 2. And you could have developed this using geometry alone. You didn't have to do matrix operations, but I wanted to show you that these two are equivalent. And this one obviously is L1, C1. And very similarly to the vertical part. Again, this is the vertical part of this triangle. And again, this is L2 sine theta 1 plus theta 2, and this is L1 sine theta 1. And then you can actually add them together. But more importantly, let's take a look at this part right here, the orientation. In both of these two frames, A1 and A2, we always rotate about Z. Is that right? And then, as a result, if you look at this, where's the last one? Yeah, here. Here. So, in this particular example, the orientation essentially is Z12. What does that mean? See, in the first example, in the first action, we rotate about theta 1. Rotate about Z, angle theta 1. And then here, we also rotate about Z again. Also theta 2. So therefore, the total, since they are both on the same, they are both rotating about Z, so that's why the rotations are simply added together. And this is one of the lovely features about planar robots, that there will always going to be only one rotation, which is rotate about Z, and it's always going to be the summation of all the angles involved. Okay? And this is one of the features of the planar robot, and makes its analysis relatively easier to go, especially in forward kinematics. Okay,
this behavior is normal in robots, in planar robots, the movement along XY plane and the rotation is about Z. With this, that's why it's the feature of it. And now the next exercise. Now, what happens if you want to add a third link? So L3. I'm going to pause again here. I want you to think about it. First of all, I would like to find out A3, or the third matrix that describes this link right here. Then I would like to find out how I developed the matrix for the whole robot. All right? Think about it for a minute. I'll give you a moment. Pause this video and then try to think about it and figure out if you can develop the whole matrix, and then come back and watch this video. Once again, I strongly suggest that you stop or pause and then come back and watch this part with me. Okay, let's carry on. So what's going on here is essentially up until this point, right? This is essentially a 2D OF, is that right? So rather than repeating the process from the beginning, all we really have to do is to take whatever we did with a 2D OF and simply add one more frame. That's basically it. So if you remember the 2D OF, right? The 2D OF that we developed last time, what was it? Was essentially A1, A2. And okay, and if you remember A1, what was it? It was essentially rotate about Z, theta, okay, theta 1, yeah? And then followed by translate X L1, is that right? And then we repeated the same process for A2. It was exactly the same matrix, is that right? But the only thing, the difference is that here we have theta 2 and over here we have L2. Is that right? It was also rotate about Z and also translate along Z, and that was theta 2. Well, if you're gonna add one more link, then all you really have to do is just add one more A here. So A3, again rotate about Z, but now you're gonna have theta 3, and over here you will have L3. This angle looks like it's going in the opposite direction compared to these other two. It doesn't matter. If you want, you can consider it as a negative angle, like say 50, negative an angle, because it's going in the opposite direction. Or you can, I think that's the answer. Yes, if because it's going in the opposite direction, then you can consider it as a negative angle. Or because we are just using symbolic equations, it doesn't matter. We just put theta 3 as is. You don't have to put negative theta 3. Because just because it's rotating in this direction now, it can always rotate in the other direction in some other time. So that's why we can ignore the sign and we just think about it as simply as just theta 3. So the answer to this question, let me revise that answer. So what if this arrow looks in the opposite direction than the others? Don't worry, we are working with symbolic or variables. Just because it's going in this direction now, it doesn't mean that it cannot go in the opposite direction in later time. So we're just going to ignore it as, we're going to consider it as theta 3. And later on, the value happens to be negative or positive. That could be in that situation alone. Okay, so what's the significance? Well, the significance is that you already have basically developed the matrix for 2D OF by multiplying the first two frames. Is that right? By multiplying A1 and A2, right? So basically, the 3D OF matrix, essentially now, is equal to what? A1 multiplied by A2 multiplied by A3. Is that right? Well, we already have this because this is the 2D OF. Is that right? So all you really have to do is just add one more A, which is the A3, multiply it, post-multiply it by the 2D OF matrix, and you end up with a 3D OF matrix again. And that's exactly what's shown here. So the matrix, let me change to a highlighter here. So again, the robot matrix for a 3D of freedom planar robot is simply equal to A1 multiplied by A2 multiplied by A3. But the first two frames are essentially the 2D OF matrix, which we developed from before, which is right here. You get me? That's a terrible job highlighting things. So I'm going to erase that. And then we use the line again. I'm going to use the line, and we have a color, which is red. So this is essentially... sorry about that, guys. Okay, so let's change back to a pen. Okay, so now, essentially, this is now the
the 2 degree of freedom robot, and this is the A3 representation. And once again, notice that we use similarity here, because it's exactly the same actions like A1 and A2. We just use the same template for that matrix. We just substitute to 3 values. So 3, 3, 3, L3, and cosine and sine T3. And then we multiply again, and once again, the multiplication. And in an earlier example, when I developed the 2 degree of freedom, I showed you in detail the steps. How did I come up from the beginning until the end? Yeah. But now I will leave this exercise for you, which is to start at this point and end up here. How did I actually come up with C1, 2, 3, which is essentially cosine 1 and 2 and 3 altogether? But I'll give you a hint. You can end up with a situation where you have C1, 2, C3, and then over here you're going to get minus S1, 2, and then S3. So obviously this is angle 1 plus angle 2, but angle 1 happens to be 1 and 2, and angle 2 happens to be 3. So that results in adding them all together. So basically, go ahead and do this exercise on your own and try to see. Once again, this is another situation where you can see whether or not you are learning now how to do matrix multiplications in simple form, and how you also can manipulate the trigonometric relationships as well. And notice once again that this is also true. This is now PX for 3D, and this is now PY for 3D. And notice also that once again we are always rotating about Z again, but we are adding all the angles together. So again, just like we agreed here that we are adding the two angles together, by adding another link, all we're really doing is just continue that process. You know what I mean? We just simply rotate about now. Essentially, the position of this point or the end of the robot is going to be adding the components of all links together, right? So this is essentially is L1, C1, and this right here is L2, C1, 2, and this right here is L1. This is basically theta 3, and this is theta 1, 2. So this is 1, 2, and this is 3, resulting in theta or C. 1, 2, 3. So that's how we can, and also notice that all of the angles are rotate about Z. So we simply add them all together. And that is once again what is shown here. Okay, so I think we are done with the graphical example. Let's move on now to the next point. And that will be what happens if we are dealing with a three-dimensional complex robot, or a custom-made robot that is not an industrial example. What happens there? Oh, by the way, before I get to this, if you are wondering, why did I skip the articulate robot? The reason why I skipped the articulate robot is because if we're going to end up with three rotations, rotate about Y, then rotate about, first rotate about X, Y, and Z, that's the Euler angles. And these three rotations will result in quite a complicated matrix here. So I decided not to dwell on that for now, because three rotations in a row, they'll be quite and every one of them is in a different plane. Rotate about X, rotate about Y, rotate about Z. These are all three different planes. In a 3DOF planar robot, where is it? Here in this particular example, although we have three rotations, yeah, what is it? Yeah, here, we have three We have three rotations, yes, but they are all rotate about Z. That is why they were simply added together, okay? However, if you have three rotations on different planes, let's say rotate about X, followed by rotate about Y, followed by rotate about Z. And by the way, this is the very definition of one type of articulate robot, and this is called Euler angles. Okay, so as an exercise, go ahead and try to develop the T matrix for this system. It's not really used for manipulators, it's usually used for end effectors, but just bear with me. And on your own and try to develop this matrix.
The order is in the wrong way. The Z first, the Y, and then the X comes last. Yeah. Okay. And there is another example of this, and that is rotate Z followed by rotate Y and then rotate Z again. And the difference between this matrix and by the way, this is another Z, yeah? So why do it again? We are not doing it again because once you make a rotation, Z has already moved. Once you do this rotation, then Z has already moved. And now we have Z as moved. So this is the local Z. So this local Z is different than this Z now. This is essentially, which one is Euler? Which one is RPY? I apologize, guys. Sorry. This is actually is RPY. In other words, roll, pitch, yaw, angle. Roll, pitch, yaw, we have seen them in the earlier chapters when we were talking about the theoretical parts. So this is the matrix for roll, pitch, yaw, which is rotate Z, Y, and X. But these guys, which is rotate Z, rotate Y, rotate Z again, these are Euler angles. And the purpose or the differences between them is operational, means they have different purposes. But as you can see, they both involve three rotations about three different planes or three different axes. That will result in a very complicated matrix. If you want, you can go ahead and do it on your own time as an exercise and try to see how lovely that matrix will look like. Okay, so, all right, so if geometry is not possible and if standard operations does not help us much, what then? Or if I have a complex robot that does not fit any of the description that I've seen so far, what do I do then? Well, your best guess is to try to visualize it yourself or try to apply the DH method. The DH method is named after two scientists, Dinavert and Hardenberg. They developed the same idea or the same method independently, so that's why it was named after them. And the DH method essentially, and if you remember earlier today, or when we talked about this earlier, when I was talking about the visual or the graphical solution, we saw that there are multiple solutions for the visual problem, right? In an earlier example, when I said that, you know, this is our target frame, right? And this is our last frame or our final frame. This is the starting frame and this is the final frame. There are different routes to get from A to Z. Is that right? Excuse me. The fogging got into my mouth. Okay, so in order for, now this was not a problem. When you have multiple solutions, let me open up that example again, yeah? So in this other matrix that we've seen before, I think it was here, right? Yeah, I think it was here. No, it wasn't here, it was in another slide. It was in transformations, yeah? So transformations here. And I think it was in those slides. Yeah. Yeah, this one right here. Don't hang, please. Yeah. So let's now take a look at. So remember in this example, we said that this is one solution and this is another solution. They're basically the same problem, but two different solutions. In fact, there are endless amount of solutions that I can come up with, right? So this was not a problem if we are dealing with numbers, meaning if the value is equal to numbers, as you can see here, right? What do you mean by numbers? See, this transformation and this transformation, they're dealing with numbers. Over here, we have 1.9. Let me put the pen here. Yeah. So here we have 1.9, and here we have 90 degrees, and here we have 180. And in the other solution, we have 1.9 again, and here we have 180, and here we have 90, all right? So basically what that means is that you're going to substitute these values in these different solutions or different paths, but once everything becomes numbers and you multiply them all together, eventually you're going to get to the same results. So it doesn't matter if you are dealing with numbers, but what if we are dealing with symbols? So imagine if this wasn't 1.9, if this was, let me change the color, yeah? Let's say if this was L1. And over here, the other matrix right here, this is now theta 1. And over there, this is now theta 2. And we have no idea what's the value for L1, theta 1, and theta 2. And then over here, we can back now and we put again L1 and L and again theta 2. This again. Let's try to clean this up. And also, I want to change the color. So change the color to red. Okay. So yeah, once again, let's imagine that we have here L1. And over here, we have again theta 1. And over here is theta 2. So what's the big deal, you say? Well, over here, you can see, okay, this one is not a problem because it's the same matrix. But over here now, we have rotate z theta 1. So the matrix or the solution calls for rotate about z theta 1 multiplied by rotate x theta 2. Is that right? But if I go back to the other solution now, the answer here is different. And you can see here now it says rotate about y theta 1 and then followed by rotate about z theta 2. Okay, so as you can see now, things are different. You know what I mean? So let me clean this ugly line here. Yeah. And pen again. Yeah. All right. So basically here, you can see now that essentially, let's ignore the translation for a second. You see how we have rotate about y angle theta 1 and rotate about z theta 2. And then here we have another solution altogether. It says now rotate about z theta 1 and then rotate about x theta 2. So that will result in a completely different matrix altogether. You have two separate solutions. And believe it or not, they're both valid. They're both valid. So, but then the problem is that we have one robot, or we have one particular robot, but then with two equally correct equations, or two equally sets of equations. This is not good, because now you're going to end up with two sets of equations that can describe the robot. And then that will be result in a problem when you, let's say I'm in one company and you are in another company or in another business or another organization, and I adopted solution one and you adopted solution two, but then we will want to work together and you have two different solutions for the same problem. That is not standardized. And that is the key word here. We didn't say that these are wrong or mistakes. We just said that these are not standardized. Standardized means that they are not following the same path. Not standard. And because they are not standard, we're going to have compatibility and other problems in the future. And that's why this was the motivation behind the DH method. The DH method, coming back here, right? The Dilbert Hahnemann realized this problem. They realized that you can actually solve the same problem multiple ways. So instead, what they developed was they decided to standardize the journey. So instead, like I did, in one solution, we said rotate about Z, then rotate about Y. And then we said rotate about X, and then rotate about Y. But so which one is correct? What DH says simply, you know what? We're going to agree from now on that this is the correct way of going. This is the steps that you have to do in order to transform from frame A to frame B. What does the DH method says? It simply defines... it simply says that if you want to transform from an old frame to a new frame, then you must follow this particular set of actions. That you have to do the following action. Translate along Z, rotate about Z, then translate along X, and rotate about X. That's it. And you have to do it in this particular order. Now, how you do it and what are the rules about it, there is a long story that I don't want to go through. This is by itself requires a separate video. How you're going to go about these steps and how you're going to develop the frames and so on and so forth. So for our syllabus in this course, we don't have to go through that today. But for those watching YouTube, I'm going to develop a separate video only for the DH method, describing it in detail, but that will be in a later time. But let's just say that you agreed on that. So the transformations from frame one to frame two will have to follow the following actions, as you can see here. Now, it's not necessarily that you must have a value every time. It's possible that, for example, that we don't need this translation along D, for example. Then in this case, the value for D will be 0, and then we can ignore this first step. But you have to check first. Then similarly here, maybe we don't need to rotate about Z. Simply, maybe after you double check all of these four steps, you realize that only this one is needed. Then in this case, that's enough. But you have to follow this particular route and you have to check according to the procedure of the DH method. Then we also have to develop the parameters table, and then we use the parameters table to do matrix multiplications as usual, and so on and so forth. Now, what you need to, the getaway or the, you know, the takeaway from this is simply is that the DH method standardizes the process of visualizing the robot and standardizes the steps they needed to transform from one frame to another, resulting in a very standard solution. That's all you need to learn if you are from the course. How and the details, that will be in another day. Now, I have another question, which is this guy right here. If you notice all of these four actions, they involve Z and X. So you rotate about Z, translate along Z, rotate about X, translate along Z. Well, what about the Y axis? I'll give you a moment to think about it. You can pause and think about it, but then I will answer it after that. Okay, I hope you thought about it correctly. But if you remember, it's because when you want to draw a, if you remember that when you want to draw a frame, you always apply the other right-hand rule, which is you will have here Z, and you will have here X, and this is your thumb, and therefore Y can be found easily using the middle finger. So if this was your thumb, and this is your index finger, so this is your middle finger, and this is your other two fingers here. All right? So this is how you apply the right-hand rule to, we were doing great. Now to draw this whole thing again. Thankfully, we didn't have to do that. So essentially, this is the right-hand rule, right? And according to the right-hand rule, all you need is just your thumb and your index, and then the right-hand rule will apply directly on the middle finger. Again, if you remember the properties of the frame matrix, we said that you don't need all the three cosines. We only need two of the three cosines in order for you to draw the matrix. So that's why we don't really need the y-axis altogether. We just need the first two only, the x and z, and then after that, you will be more than enough to solve the system. That's why sometimes, if you look at some other books or other resources, and you look at pictures about frames, you will notice that they don't draw the y-axis altogether. They only draw the x and z, because the y-axis is not needed. Okay, moving on. Okay, so all of that, if you remember from the beginning of this session today, that we said that essentially this video is divided into two parts. This session is divided into two parts. And we spent nearly 1 hour and a half, or maybe 1 hour and 10 minutes, on only about development of the frame matrix. That's how significant this part is. I told you before that once you have the frame matrix, then the rest is easy. And that is actually true. Although this looks like a lot of things over here, but actually it isn't. It's quite straightforward, and as you shall see in a minute. Once you develop the T-matrix, and we did, okay? If you think about it, we have already developed the T-matrix for this guy, and this guy, this one, and I'll show you what's going on here later, but we have already developed the T-matrix for all of these robots. So now what we need to do next is simply use it in order to develop the forward kinematics equations. Well, let's do that. And we will, and you will see how fast this will happen now. And when I said earlier that, robot forward kinematics is the easiest part. And then we went through all of this stuff here. You might be thinking, what is he talking about? I meant this part. And I said it before, as soon or as long as the robot matrix is available, then forward kinematics is pretty much straightforward. Let's see how that, what did I mean by that? So let's start again with the same robot that we worked with in the beginning, the standard robots. And a little bit of recap first. So first of all, from the earlier chapters, we defined forward kinematics being that if you are giving robot parameters, in this example or in this line, I did not put LI, but it's understood that it's there. If you're giving robot parameters, then you can find the pose of the robot. Pose is in means the position, the pose of the end effector, yeah? The position and orientation of the end effector. In this particular view, the position and orientation simply means of the frame of the end effector. So meaning essentially not only the X and Y coordinates, but also mean the orientation, and that will be defined in this angle. Okay, Example, if you want a numerical example, in this particular example, we are ignoring L's because L's are constant. You know, L1 and L2 and L3, we are ignoring them because they are constant. So assume that we are giving you these variable V values for theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. Then you plug into the equation and you find Px, Py, Pz, and as well as the orientation as well. Okay, let's do that. So here is the Cartesian robot. And if you remember, this is the matrix that we developed before, right? This is the matrix that we've seen like an hour or so ago. We said that the particular matrix for this robot actually is equal to the translation matrix of the robot. Actually, there's a bit of a tiny typo here. You know what? Yeah, let's just do it here. So I'm going to go back and do this. If you remember that, yeah, so this is supposed to be dx. Yeah. And here is dx. And here is dx. Oh, no, the other way around. Just go back here. Yeah. Oh, this is an image. Okay, well, fine. So let's do it here. Don't hang. Okay. Yeah, so basically this is the dx, right? Dx, and what happened here? Yeah, dx and dy and dz. Okay, just to differentiate between the two sides of the equation. Is that right? So let's go to slideshow and then go in front. Okay, so you see, we said that the Cartesian robot example essentially is a very straightforward example because it only involves x and z and x and y, z and x and y motions. So you can see that from the robot matrix that px, py, pz are equal here. So therefore, this is pretty much and too easy to fully grasp what's going on here. So let's move on. If this did not make any sense, I'll come back to it later. But then now let's move on here. So this is the matrix that we developed for the cylindrical robot, okay? Or at least the one that we've seen before. I told you to go and as an exercise to develop this matrix, okay? So you remember that this is a cylindrical, the T matrix or the robot matrix for the cylindrical robot. But we also know that this is a frame matrix. So this RCA actually is equal to PX, is that right? And RSA is also equal to PY, and so on. In fact, this is all true. That means PX and PY and BZ are all here. So we now can apply forward kinematics. Given robot parameters, which is in this case the reach, the height, and the twist angle, then we can simply calculate, we can simply, given means if the value of R is given, like R is equal to 5, L is equal to 3, and alpha is equal to 20 degrees, we can just simply plug them into the equations here, and we can then find the corresponding values for Px, Py, Pz. They are right here. R is equal to the value, alpha is equal to 20, R is equal to 10, plug in and calculate the values. And simply, that would be it, this is it. And then if you would like to find the orientation, then you can find these are vectors. So this is the N vector, right? And this is the O vector, and this is the Z vector. You get what I mean? So essentially, if you would like to find the orientation, all you have to do is plug in, and you can then find the orientation as well. So this is what I meant by when I say that if the robot matrix is available, then all you really have to do is just plug into the robot parameters. Because the robot matrix will be in terms of robot parameters. You just need the values. And that in forward kinematics, you are always giving the robot parameters. You just have to plug them into the equations. So this is the situation for the spherical robot. Yeah, it was a bigger and more complex matrix. Yes, okay. But then once again, once we have it ready, then we can easily convert it into this. So now Px for the spherical robot, it's a little bit more complicated, but it's again available to us. Meaning, giving this robot parameters, which is this one right here, in this case, beta, gamma, and R, which is the base, shoulder, and reach, then basically given these values, basically let's say 20 degrees, 30 degrees, and 10, just plug into the equation, plug into here, right? And then calculate the values, and that will give you directly Px, Py, Pz. And that's it. So once again, as soon as we have the matrix, then it's just a matter of plugging in the values, and voila, we're done.
And similarly, again, for our 2D OF robots, again, if you have the matrix, then you can just simply plug into the equation. You can see the patterns now. Now, giving the robot parameters theta I and Li, then you can just calculate the values for Px, Py, Pz, and so on. And once again, for the 3D OF robot, and so on and so forth. These are all the robots that we have seen so far earlier on. And once again, hopefully, you can see the pattern, what's going on here. So now, in any robot, let's say you are in your factory, all you really need is the robot matrix. You need to have this complicated matrix. And as soon as you have it, just grab the first three items here. That will be essentially result into this situation. So because the first item here will be Px, so you will have a function for Px. A function will be in terms of robot parameters. So whatever the angles and links are for the robot, as soon as you have the robot matrix, you can just extract the equation, and then you can then plug in the values and then calculate Px, Py, Pz. And you can also calculate the corresponding equations for any orientation as well. So once again, it doesn't matter how complicated the robot is, as long as the T matrix is available. Perhaps somebody else did the analysis for you. Maybe it came with a manual of the robot. Maybe your senior or engineer have done it before you arrive at the company. As soon as the table or as soon as the matrix is available, then you can just simply plug it in and use it. And by the way, this is also true for, go back a little bit more to this. Once you develop the T matrix for RPY as well as the Euler matrix, then once again, all you need to know is the angles. How much angle X, how much angle Y, how much angle Z, and you plug it in and you can find the overall orientation. And similarly, again, for Z, for the Euler angles as well. And that's it. We have basically done with forward kinematics. This is not really nothing magical. The answer is really, and by the way, let's go back to the Cartesian now. Maybe the Cartesian was difficult to see, but once again, for the Cartesian is extremely simple equation set, because essentially the value for Px is exactly the same value here, so there's nothing magical to do here. And the orientation is constant because the values of these values are already defined, so nothing magical here. So you can just ignore, or you can think of the Cartesian matrix or the Cartesian robot as extremely simple as well. And by the way, this is also true for the inverse. You see, when we go forward, we go this way. When we go inverse, we also go this way. But they're also the same thing. So that's why for inverse kinematics for Cartesian is extremely simple as well. In fact, when we talk about inverse kinematics next week or next session, we will not even talk about Cartesian. We will be simply ignore it because it's too easy. We'll start from here, from the cylindrical. Okay, and we are done. So now what you have now is a couple of exercises for you to work on. Basically, this exercise is for the cylindrical robot. Given the value for R, given the value for L, and given the value for alpha, find the position of the end effector. That's it. If you go back to the cylindrical robot, here it goes. And if you're laughing now, hopefully by now you realize what I meant when I said that the Cartesian, the forward kinematics are the easiest part of kinematics. So once again, by giving you the name of the robot, then you know which matrix to use. Therefore, you would just simply have to plug in the values in the equations, the corresponding equations, and you are good to go. Or exactly, or specifically, this situation right here. Since we are dealing with a cylindrical robot, then we get this set of equations. From this set of equations, we plug in the values, and we are good to go, and we are done here, and these are the answers. Similarly, for the spherical, exactly the same thing. Spherical robot giving the parameters. Now we have two angles and one link, and find the position. And once again, you know the trick by now. So again, since we are dealing with a spherical robot, these are the answers and these are the equations, excuse me. Plug in the values in the equations, and then you can calculate the value for X, Y, and Z, and you'll be good to go. Now, if the question asks you to find the orientation, then you'll have to find N, basically the rest of the matrix, N, O, A. You have to find the 3x3 matrix if they are asking for it. Now, what if the question did not specify a robot that you are familiar with? The robots that we are familiar with could be Cartesian, spherical, 2D UF planar, 2D UF, 3D UF planar. Then what if it was a custom robot or a customized robot? In this case, they will have to provide you with the matrix themselves. Sometimes they don't have to provide you with the whole matrix. Sometimes they will just provide you with the last column only. Okay? Because that's all we need in order to find Px and Py and Pz. You got what I mean? And if you are thinking about it, this is actually the matrix operation for the 3DOF planar robot, but with a twist that we have actually a value for Z, meaning that this planar robot is elevated up along Z. But that's basically the only difference between it and the 3DOF robot that we saw before. Yep, this is the solution. It doesn't really matter what the robot is or what's going on with it. All we really care about the fact that we have the equations, right? And here's a set of equations right here, right? And all we really need to do is just plug in the values. And here we go. Although maybe time consuming, but it's right there. It's all the values are given and all the equations are given. It's just a matter of, do you know how to use a calculator? And then you plug in and you calculate and you'll be good to go. And with this, we end this session. Let me recap everything we've covered so far. So basically, we have covered the definition of basically this is now forward kinematics, which is, as you can see, the difficult part about robot forward kinematics is to develop the frame matrix. But as soon as it's there, then the job is done. All you really have to do is just use it by simply extract the equations for Px, Py, Pz, and you'll be good to go. Next week, we will talk about the tough stuff, which is the inverse kinematics, which is the other way around. And that will be the discussion for next week. I thank you for your time. It has been already 2 hours. So thank you very much. So I'll see you in the next session. Take care.